Near enough every day, my mind will flash back to 1990.
Bobby Robson said we could all be immortal. We will live forever in, you know, English football.
I was so close to winning a World Cup, or getting into a World Cup final.
They were probably the best times of my life, and no one could take that away from us.
20 years ago, a game of football took place that restored pride in our national game.
The biggest day for English football for 24 years.
This seemed to be the one, you know, this was the one.
It's a story of triumph over adversity.
We are going to try and win the World Cup, and you have ruined that.
We did get a lot of flack, and I think it was unfair, you know.
As long as you're behind us, we're behind you.
A summer of football that united the nation.
The more games we won, the more the country partied. It was fantastic.
Football was back with a smile on its face.
And it all ended in drama and tears on that one night in Turin.
There's only one sports event where I shed a tear, and it was then.
The 4th of July 1990, the night Gaza cried and football changed forever.
Didn't want it to finish. And unfortunately, we did start crying in the middle again.
In towards Rooney!
The beautiful game, a national obsession. Today, English football is a £1 billion industry. Players are instant celebrities. Clubs are global brands. Fans pay a premium price to watch the most compelling league in world football.
Come on, United! Yes, come on!
But it wasn't always this way.
In Sheffield today, there's simply disbelief.
Horror and dismay as we see the terraces.
Throughout the day, the flowers arrived, and by evening, Hillsborough had become a memorial ground to those who died.
20 years ago, English football was in steep decline, tainted by violence and tragedy. 96 Liverpool fans were killed in Hillsborough's overcrowded pens, built to contain the hooligan culture that was blighting English football.
You went to a football match in that period knowing there could be trouble, knowing that people might get hurt.
The English public were rapidly falling out of love with their national game.
I remember going to a match in the 80s, and I thought, football's finished, you know. They were fouling each other for fun on the pitch, it seemed to me, and then there was a great deal of hooliganism around the match as well, and I thought, it's not right, there's something desperately wrong with this game.
English club sides had already been banned from all European competition 5 years earlier, but trouble continued to follow the national team on its travels.
Any time you get trouble with English fans overseas, we feel it's a blot on the fair name of our country.
With the World Cup in Italy approaching, the mood was one of fear and trepidation. Bobby Robson and his England team were under intense pressure from the media, having endured a disastrous European Championships 2 years earlier.
I don't read the papers, I've got nothing to make in that situation.
Come in, just keep it.
In 1988, the European Championship had been bad for England. I mean, Bobby Robson was slated by the press, and I mean, they wanted him to resign, sack Robson all over the papers. A lot of it was unfair at the time, and it was horrible, and he was very, very hurt by it.
Come on, Bob.
I distinctly remember the press conferences that Dad had to go through, and that I would watch from afar.
The news conference then degenerated into a shambles as Robson threatened to walk out, angered by the persistence of photographers.
His face during the press conferences when the press were gunning for him, because I can distinctly remember the press, you know, wanted him out of the job, and they didn't get away. It stirred things up even more, really, and got even nastier.
some of the things that he went through, certainly that I was involved with, I think probably were unacceptable, quite personal attacks. It was a vicious circulation war where we were in an era where anything went.
One of Robson's fiercest critics was Mirror football writer Nigel Clarke.
I don't feel any remorse about what I wrote about Bobby, because I couldn't understand why he made the decisions he made and chose to play the way he did. And so, yes, I got into his ribs. That's my job. Press conference began, you say, thanks for turning me over again, Nigel. I was like, OK, Bob, any time.
Just 2 weeks before the start of the tournament, the Sun leaked the news that Robson would be leaving the England manager's job after the World Cup, having signed a contract to manage PSV in the Dutch league.
The FA said to him that they weren't going to renew his post, his contract, and he knew he had to seek employment elsewhere, which he did. But he got massive criticism for that. It was like he was unpatriotic, and he'd put himself first before the country. If you knew Bobby Robson, that was never ever the case.
We are going abroad to try and win the World Cup for our country with a decent bunch of players, and you have ruined that. Some of you have ruined that.
All it did was unite the camp even more. If it could have been united anymore, because each and every player that was involved or played under Sir Bobby Robson had a great love for him, and and I was no exception. What we wanted to do was we wanted to win it for him.
June 1990. The stage was set for football's showpiece event in one of the world's most passionate footballing nations. Italia 90 was to take place in some of Europe's finest stadia, and all played out to the soundtrack of Puccini and Pavarotti. But while the footballing elite took their place on mainland Italy, England and their supporters, the outcasts of world football, were quarantined on the island of Sardinia. England's opening match pitted them against Jack Charlton's island.
Made it towards Lineker. It's a goal for England, surely. Gary Lineker. Butcher, Sheedy playing it in again. McMahon singing their team. Gets it away, Sheedy. 1-1.
After the first match, there were calls for the team to go home in the red tops, disgrace, send them home, what a waste of time.
And England could have a real problem now.
Really, it's been shambles second half. If they play like that against Holland, they might as well not turn up.
Everybody's depressed and everybody is, again, I suppose, very critical. You said people back home, we've had a hammering again.
But the players certainly didn't like the criticism of Robson at the start of the World Cup. And I can remember, for instance, no press conferences for about a week because the players refused to talk to the media.
So it's secret.
Especially for you.
I was there as a sports correspondent for ITN. My job was to just cover the England team, and we got, reasonably close to Bobby Robson, but the team were very suspicious of the media. There was a real tension, I have to say.
Everybody seems to just be slaughtering, picking out the bad points all the time, non-stop, and it's a joke. Keep faith in us, because as long as you're behind us, we're behind you, and we will give 100% every time. And don't believe everything you read.
The press were discussing really towards that tournament. We did get a bit flack, and I think it was unfair, Bobby, cancelled the newspapers, getting arriving to the hotel, so we never got to see any of it. Keeping that side of it out of it made us better, and we didn't know what was going on,
And what that did, that gave us a siege mentality. And the more the World Cup went on and progressed, the more determined we were to stick together.
Coming up, a bold new England team emerges as Robson proves the doubters wrong.
Sweet as a nutter, captain.
And England's precocious young star comes of age.
World Cup 1990 was the best time of my life. I just absolutely loved it,
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Italia 90 was in full flow.
Roger Miller! Oh! It's his day, all right!
A World Cup with the power to create new footballing heroes.
Mateus can go again. Oh, great goal!
But after their lacklustre start, England looks set to remain amongst the also-rans of world football. England's poor showing against the Irish had led to a vicious backlash in the media. But the press had underestimated Robson and his team. A tactical switch to a continental sweeper system was employed in England's next game against the Dutch. A rejuvenated England outplayed the European champions on a night when their young playmaker finally announced himself on the world stage. Having forced his way into the England squad late in the day, Paul Gascoigne was England's secret weapon.
I can remember the moment where things turned around completely. Gazza did a Cruyff turn and completely flat-footed a couple of Dutch players. Now, as part of the inferiority that we had, we thought everything Dutch was brilliant. They were the inventors of total football. Johan Cruyff, they knew exactly what they were doing. And here was one of our own doing to them what they'd been doing to us for years.
Oh, it's going to stop brilliantly here.
Things I used to do when I was younger, all I did is just used all them skills that I learned when I was younger and done it in the World Cup, you know? The Johan Cruyff turn and beating other players four or five at a time.
But here's Gascoigne now. Challenge and still there. Oh, it was a foul, surely.
So Bobby always says, Gazza, we need two balls, one for you and one for the team.
That's a brave run from Gascoigne, gone for the heart of the defence.
Gascoigne has sublime skills, an ability to take people on, to go past people, to see a pass. He was very, very creative. He was something that hadn't been produced in England for a very, very long time.
And I remember he used to call me Gaz after games. As soon as the game finished, I wasn't really listening to Sir Bobby after the game. I'd just get on the phone and the shower and ring me dad, how's it going? Did I play all right, you know? But I knew I did well.
A newer, more expansive England team was emerging with rising stars like Platt and Wright. Barnes and Waddle were the flair players. Lineker, the ace goal scorer with the clean-cut image. Shilton, the veteran goalkeeper in his last campaign. Hardman, Butcher and Pierce epitomise the team's never-say-die attitude. But it was Gascoigne who was the centre of attention on and off the pitch. Life with Gazza was never dull.
Oh, jeez! No chocolate!
In many ways, he's one of the last to have had a direct link to the fans. You know, he was the guy who you could imagine having a beer with after the game.
I'm the same guy as the guy that's on the dole back in where I live in Dunson. I mean, because I kick a stupid football about on a Saturday, that I've got to be different from him.
World Cup 1990 was the best time of my life. I mean, it was great. I just absolutely loved it, you know.
He was a pest, really, in the hotels. I mean, he didn't sleep. He was on the tennis court, he was playing table tennis, he was swimming, he was doing all kinds of things. So he was just unbelievable.
It was like having a 10-year-old boy around you. He was mad.
Chrissy Waddle was his roommate. Chrissy Waddle was always in our room just to escape him. So it's unbelievable because Chrissy Waddle just wanted to get away because he didn't stop.
Had race nights. Gary Lineker and myself were bookmakers.
And the back marker is Jake Lambert.
When Gazza's around, he's always going to cause some sort of problem or other, or keep players on their toes.
It was a time when a drinking culture was still an accepted part of life in the England squad.
He was part of the escape committee that we formed in Sardinia. We used to go down to this little bar. If it came down to a drinking World Cup, we would have won it hands down. And you think of the drinking that we did and the socialising and the laughs that we had. It was like a lad's sort of like, you know, 6-week bender or stag sort of do.
We want to get loaded and we want to have a good time.
The thing about it was that the players, when it came down to training, when it came down to what it really mattered was the football, the lads were like, bang, it's like a switch. They just turned it on and they could do it.
Last
week's number one is this week's number two. It's a Adamski with Killer. We promised you a special surprise, and here it is. Our new number one is the best football song ever, England New Order. And live by satellite in Sardinia, we should have John Barnes and Paul Gascoigne. Gentlemen, welcome to Top of the Pops, and congratulations.
Gazza, tell me about the training and how preparations are going for the big match coming up on Monday. How are things going?
Well, that has absolutely nothing to do with the Rebels.
A World Cup song for the Acid House generation. A group of players the fans could identify with. After years in the doldrums, football was becoming fashionable again.
World emotion was fantastic, particularly because the players had a huge involvement in it as well. We went to number one whilst we were out there in Sardinia. It was a feel-good factor as well. It helped to have a good song behind us.
Back in Italy, England were growing stronger with each game.
Sterling well there.
England had won the group, round two, Belgium and Bologna.
Only England could find a way of preventing this drama of the penalties now. Well, maybe Gascoigne.
Deep into extra time, Robson's men were only seconds away from the dreaded penalty shootout.
If England could just unlock the door with this free kick, we'd be saved all that drama.
What followed will live long in the memory of any England fan. It was a moment that would change the life of one England player forever.
It's the last minute. We get a free kick in the middle of the park. And I do what I would do. I go and get into the box.
Chip in there. And Player scored!
And let me tell you, 9 times out of 10, I'm not connecting with that ball. Certainly not as sweet as I did there. It's just perfect timing. It's just sweet as a nut, I catch it. I mean, it's past the keeper before he can even think about it. That goal in particular is what made my World Cup.
David Platt has clinched it for England in the last seconds of extra time.
I am constantly thanked for the feeling that it gave people, my goal against Belgium. Supporters, my generation now, my age now, know where they was when I scored that goal.
Then all of a sudden, things got better. England are in the quarterfinals, and on the bench, they're all smiles. Look at Bobby Robson's smile.
It was just an incredible feeling and an incredible buzz. And they had this dance, let's all have a disco, and they'd jump up and down and punch it and all that stuff. Let's all have a disco and all that. He did that. Yeah, it was funny, yeah. Those moments you don't want to let go, those moments you don't want to ever end. Crap now, though, but it was funny at the time when I was a lot fitter and a lot slimmer. It was, I was partly on, and the more games we won, the more we partied as a team, certainly did, the more the fans partied, and the more the country partied as well. It was fantastic.
All of a sudden, I think a country, media as well, looked at it and thought, hang on a minute here, we're playing Cameroon in the quarterfinals. This is practically, we're through to the semi-finals. We play Cameroon, we get through to the semi-finals. God, anything can happen.
England started well.
Lineker towards the near post, and a good header down in. Platt has done it.
But they had underestimated the Cameroons.
Miller, that's going to be a penalty. It's 1-1.
Who hit back with 2 goals.
Has developed for England. Touching again, and that's surely a penalty.
As so often before, England were rescued by the cool nerve of their star striker.
Here he goes. It is 2-2.
Lineker won and converted 2 vital penalties.
3-2. The referee looks at the watch. The final whistle. England are in the semi-finals of the 1990 World Cup.
Now they're only two games away from winning the thing, so everybody's upbeat now. Everybody's thinking, wow, listen, what a good guy Bobby Robson is, by the way.
Even England's fiercest critics were jumping on the bandwagon. 3 weeks earlier, they called to send them home. Now, they were writing a different story.
Suddenly, we're all on the phone, because in those days there's no laptops. We're all on the phone, ad-libbing, England last night sensationally came through, blah, blah, blah. England heroes, Platy on the back, Robson. And suddenly, everything had changed. We can play, we can beat them, we can win the World Cup. And of course, what happened was one of the most dramatic matches in England's World Cup history.
Still to come, England prepares for its biggest match in a quarter of a century.
Just point to the three lines and just say, that is what it's all about.
Lineker will bounce, come for Lineker!
Everybody was up. We'll win this now.
Good morning to you. It's 6 o'clock on Wednesday, the 4th of July, American Independence Day, and also the biggest day for English football for 24 years.
It's the final whistle! England are in the semi-finals of the 19th.
They had entered the tournament under a barrage of criticism and abuse, but now England found themselves just one game away from a World Cup final. Nelson Mandela was visiting 10 Downing Street, and the Rolling Stones were set to play a sell-out concert at Wembley Stadium. But there was only one thing on most people's minds. Football.
Final preparations are underway for England's most important football match.
Car companies expect one of the biggest electricity demands ever.
Here we are in the semi-final.
It's a World Cup semi-final. Football's our national game. We're going to go into the World Cup final. It's 1990, we haven't been there since 1966. Goodness me. What? You know, you put it on the television, I'm sorry, the whole country's going to stop and going to watch it.
The rush hour came early as many struggled to get home to watch the big game. An hour before kick-off, Newcastle city centre was deserted, except for those rushing to get seated in front of the television before the match started.
Whether you were a football fan or not, it was simply unmissable.
And I remember saying, half the population of the country are going to watch this. And I said, what the other half are doing, I can't imagine. Because I couldn't imagine it, because it seemed to me as a football fan, and this was such a fantastic occasion, why wasn't everybody watching it?
Sales at off licences were up as people stopped to pick up a little liquid refreshment.
We didn't know what was happening back home, we didn't know that it was building up unbelievably well, and the interest and the noise and all these kinds of things, it was incredible. We didn't know that.
Live from Turin, England against West Germany for a place on the world's finest stage and the possibility of eternal glory in the eternal city of Rome.
Those fortunate enough to be in the Stadio delle Alpi that evening waited expectantly for the drama about to unfold.
I can remember thinking to myself, this is a great privilege to be covering this. I can remember getting, you know, phone calls from home, people saying, can you believe how lucky you are? You know, it beats working.
It was absolutely fantastic being at the World Cup as a seven-year-old with my dad. Absolutely wonderful experience, wouldn't change for anything. I remember there being thousands and thousands of England fans at the beginning of the game, being a really, really great atmosphere and really, really loud.
I mean, I'd done Olympics and previous World Cups and all sorts of things in my broadcasting life, luckily, but this seemed to be the one. You know, this was the one.
Just minutes to go until kickoff, England's players were preparing for the biggest game of their lives.
The atmosphere amongst the players in the dressing room, you know, was intense, to say the least.
When you got Terry Butcher in your side, who was a very, very strong-minded lad, he'd be punching the walls and saying, "This is for England. You got to get out there. And you got to do it." So all of a sudden, you know, you're wanting to fight the world.
Terry Butcher was shouting, "This is my house, this is my home. No one beats me in my own house, you know."
How can you
think about motivating a team to play in a World Cup semi-final, there's no motivation needed. You just point to the badge. Just point to the three lions and just say, that is what it's all about.
Bobby Robson came up, he just stood up, he said, can I have a little bit of quiet? And he went, before this game starts, I want to tell you how proud I am of each and every one of you for getting this far. And you know what? Even to now, that brings tingles, because that, you know, to me, because he was genuine, he was proud of us all. And he said, and I look at you all as sons. I mean,
he said, we could all be immortal. And that was his phrase, which, you know, stirs the blood and gets you going. You know, we could all be immortal. We will live forever in, you know, English football.
Standing in their way were the formidable West Germans. They'd cruised through the earlier rounds and were the hot favourites to lift the World Cup. The stage was set for another titanic clash between two of football's great rivals.
After 89, the finish of the Berlin Wall and the finishing of the east part of Germany, the people come together so close to celebrate together the first time a football competition. We had a huge concentration and the whole team were convinced to win the World Cup in Italy.
England started strongly.
Indeed, a shot from Gascoigne.
Surprisingly, the game was more open than I thought it would be. You know, I thought that it would be a lot tighter. I mean, it was really end-to-end football, and I think that's why it's remembered as such a terrific game.
Joan, trying something from long range, shot and a good save.
England had dominated for long periods of the first half.
Crossed in once more, and Lineker almost getting on the end of it.
But had failed to make the breakthrough.
If you find yourself sitting on the edge of your seats at home, don't worry, I'm sure that there are millions in our country doing the same.
15 minutes into the second half, the West Germans were awarded a free kick.
I couldn't see them scoring unless it was something really lucky or something really spectacular. I got my wall lined up. Everything was great because we were well prepared for set plays.
And now comes the big, dangerous moment for England.
I was told to get out there and block. I'd done what I could, but the ball hit me.
Next thing you see it go up in the air, you think, well, that's okay because Peter's there. That horrible moment, you think, he ain't going to get there. And he hasn't got there. And it's in the back of your net.
Curled off. Disgust.
I've seen it a million times. Should Peter Shilton have saved it? Was he a bit slow getting there? There's only one person in this world that knows whether he could have saved it, and that's Shilton himself.
You're going to get people making comments, but really they don't know what they're talking about. As a goalkeeper, you've really sort of got no chance in that situation. It was just a fluke goal.
For the millions watching back home, it was a devastating blow.
Oh, our luck has now finally run out. This is woeful. You know, this is Germany, after all, the uber-successful team. We're not going to get back in here.
I kind of remember thinking, oh, it's just not going to be our idea. They've got the luck on their side. Just had to get our heads down, get back in the match.
As the clock ticked down, Robson's men poured forward in search of an equaliser.
Gascoigne knocks it in there, and just wide from Mark Wright and Pierce both up there.
England were 10 minutes away from being knocked out of the World Cup.
Somehow I found myself over the halfway line. I just put a ball into what I assumed was a decent area. Gary does what he does best.
And Lineker, will the bounce come for Lineker? It might come.
I just remember the noise of the crowd. Going absolutely mad and everybody jumping up and hugging, which made me realise what had actually happened. Even the Italian police, I think, were enjoying the fact that England had scored.
Look at the joy on the face of England's goalscorer!
I've only ever seen
an English press box get off their feet twice in my career. Once was when Lineker equalised with 10 minutes to go against Germany in 1990, and the other one was Michael Owen's goal against Argentina in 1998. And they're the only times I've seen the cynical bunch that we are get off our feet and actually punch the air and say, you know, yes, come on.
The joy in the stadium was shared by millions in pubs and living rooms across the land. ''90 minutes were up. Extra time would be required.
15 minutes each way to come in extra time. West Germany 1, England 1 here in Turin. We take a short break and then you'll be back for the action.
We thought, oh, this is its turn for us. The German heads will go down because they thought they'd won it. Everybody was up. We'll win this now.
What happened next remains etched on the minds of all those who witnessed it. Coming up.
I seen the referee with a yellow card, hopefully. I was devastated.
He's not far from tears there.
God, I'm going to miss the final. I'll forget if I win, you know.
It'll be England's first ever penalty shootout. A place in the World Cup final at stake.
Turin, 4th of July, 1990. England versus West Germany for a place in the World Cup final. Gary Lineker's late equaliser had rescued England and taken the game into extra time.
ITV looking for Coronation Street. That'll come up after this World Cup semi-final that stands at 1-1 in the first period.
Bobby Robson and his team were within touching distance of their dream, but it was a dream that was about to turn into a nightmare for their star player.
Into Gascoigne's path. Trying to shoulder a defender out of the way.
I think there was a huge collective groan when Gazza lunges in for the tackle. We're all saying, don't go for it, don't go for it. Oh, he's gone for it.
A yellow card for Paul Gascoigne, which means that if England go into the World Cup final, sadly for Gascoigne, he will not be a part of it.
I seen the referee with a yellow card, hopefully. I was devastated. I mean, the first thing I just went through my mind is like, God, I'm going to miss the final, I'll forget if I win, you know.
Look at that, oh my goodness, look at that look on his face. He knows he's not far from tears there.
And there was an amazing turn to Bobby Robson by Lineker, you know, watch him. And a picture that will live long with us.
And I still, to this day, when I look at it, I still don't think I touched him, you know. I mean, seeing the guy, what, 6'4", rolling about like a little kid, you know, it drove his nuts when I still see it, you know.
Me?
No, I'm not the type to make that kind of stuff. It was a foul, but you don't care if a referee gives a booking with the other players, you know.
And the crowd here in Turin chanting, "We love you, Gazza," trying to lift him again.
With the game on a knife edge, both teams went in search of the goal that would take them to the final.
We had chances, they had chances. Particularly remember the chance that Chris Waddle had.
Now, if that's an inside, that's a goal. Whoa, how close were we to actually getting into a World Cup final? And I think that's the difference.
West Germany also came agonisingly close.
Oh,
but 2 hours of football had failed to separate the two teams.
It'll be England's first ever penalty shootout. And what a time for it to come. A place in the World Cup final at stake.
I was there to take one of the penalties. Obviously, I think with the state of mind I was in, it was best that I didn't take the penalty, you know.
For those watching, the tension was almost unbearable.
Gary, the whole nation is watching you now.
If you can imagine walking from the halfway line to the penalty spot in a penalty shootout, knowing that if you miss, the nation is out. Millions and millions of people watching back home. It's down to you to score.
Gary Lineker with penalty number one. 1-0 to England.
I remember the main thing about the penalties was being excited that they're at our end. That was the first great thing. As the penalties were going through, I basically couldn't look.
Now, can Peter Shilton save this one?
I knew what I was going to do anyway, that I was basically going to wait as long as I could and try and read the penalty so that if it's hit straight at me, I've still got a chance.
I'd played with Peter Shilton for many years, for Southampton and then to Derby and with England, and I'd never seen him save a penalty.
Bremer v Shilton. It's there, that's 1-1.
There was something about the penalty shootout that made it perfect television, even for people who didn't really follow football.
Nation urging Peter Beardsley to stick it in the back of the net, which he's done.
The drama was etched out there. You either scored or you didn't.
Mateus with the shot. 2-2. David Platt, penalty taker for Aston Villa.
Your mind is trying to think about billions watching at home, about the magnitude of he miss, about this, that, the other. I knew what I was going to do with the penalty going into it, but changed my mind.
David Platt.
I mean, even walking back, I knew that I would never change my mind ever again on a penalty, because I should have put it the other side.
England and their fans prayed for a West German miss.
I literally had no chance with any penalty, I don't think, to be fair. The Germans are the best in the world at it.
Maybe we were more focused and more convinced to pass to the final than the English squad.
Stuart Pearce.
I think we were all confident that Stuart would do it. He was so single-minded.
First time that sort of heart sunk a little bit and realised that it may not be in our day.
And now a big job for Peter Shilton to do.
When the first one's missed, you're like, oh no, come on Peter.
The Germans with a chance to go 4-3 ahead.
If Germans score, you're like, oh my goodness, this one's got to go in.
Chris Waddle comes forward. And the only way England can survive is for Waddle to score.
I was looking down at the ground, hoping that it would just go in. As he was stepping over, the crowd just went quiet, deathly quiet.
Now, Chris Waddle. That's
it, you know, and you sort of think, am I dreaming this? Did I actually see that? Did we miss that? Are we out? You know, wow.
West Germany go into the final, and England sadly are out.
After all the hard work, you know, you were gone, really.
I was so close to winning a World Cup or getting into a World Cup final.
We were absolutely devastated.
It's heartbreaking. It is, it's heartbreaking.
I'll never get to play in a World Cup again. And so when I get to see bits of that, it is hard for me to watch it.
The two lads were distraught, weren't they? You can understand that too, you know. Carrying the hopes of the nation. There was Bobby. A hero anyway, but what might have been.
The English public and their national team were united in grief. One single image was to define the moment.
It was maybe 5, maybe even 10 minutes after the game, and Paul Gascoigne was wandering around the pitch. I mean, I was packing up like everybody else, but I picked up my camera and just took a look. Oh, that looks nice. Click, 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 click. And what amazes me is that nobody else actually seemed to take it because, I mean, there was loads of photographers around me, but they didn't. I mean, I could tell immediately I took it that it was very important. Gazza was an emotional person. He was patriotic and he was childlike, and the photograph encapsulated that.
I was crying because I knew it was the end of a tournament for me. Like I said, being in the boys' club, you know, and being with a great bunch of players, which you never get that, you know, I'll never get that again. Didn't want it to finish, and unfortunately it did.
The nation kind of put their arms around him and liked him for it, loved him for it.
A new era of following English football happened at that moment. You know, it wasn't just the guys in the pub, it was the wives, the girlfriends, and the children as well, because they loved Gascoigne for what he stood for.
Bobby Robson's team surpassed all expectations this evening, but in the end, their World Cup campaign was shattered by a footballing lottery. Mark Austin, ITN Sports, Turin.
I've shed a tear a few times when covering major disasters and witnessing terrible things and war zones and things. But there's only one sports event where I've shed a tear, and it was then. And I don't mind admitting it. You know, it was just very, very sad.
There's not much we can do, you know. It's over for us, and we've played a major part in the tournament. We've done very well to get to the semis, and we can go home, you know, feeling very proud of it, I think.
But as the England players and supporters left the Stadio Della Alpi, one young England fan had got his hands on his own piece of history.
The ball bounced and landed round row 12, just in front of us. My dad immediately, I suppose instinctively, picked up, scooped the ball up, handed it to me, put the ball in the bag, and I think we were probably one of the first people out of the stadium with the match ball. It's got unbelievable sentimental value, the ball. Unfortunately, my father passed away about 10 years ago now, so really for me it's a really, really great memory that I have of him and a great time that me and him had together in Italia 90.
July 8th, Luton Airport. 6 weeks earlier, Bobby Robson and his team had left as supposed no-hopers. Now, they returned as heroes.
I was still drunk on the plane when we landed at Luton, and we got onto the bus, separated from our families. 250,000 people at Luton. It was the most bizarre and wonderful experience ever.
We weren't prepared for it. We were told that we would have to get a police escort back to the hotel because a lot of people had come. I mean, we only went 2 miles. It took us 3.5 hours, something like that, to get there.
Being past Big Macs and burgers and chips and out under the bus, which I had to love, of course. He had the false pair of breasts on as well, and I had the stewardess's hat on.
I've never seen so many fans in all my life. Football was back with a smile on his face. It was great times.
People climbing up and on roofs. Any available space was taken. It was just a terrific feeling. I've got to say that, you know, it did cross my mind that, you know, you think, well, crikey, you know, this is to get to the semi-final. What would it have been like if we'd have won it?
I think in many ways it was a turning point. We'd had Heysel and Hillsborough and those disasters in football, and now we had something pretty joyous. So near and yet so far. I think it was a turning point, and I think from then on football did change.
England's heroic defeat in Turin had reignited the public's love of the beautiful game. The years that followed would see radical change. English clubs back in Europe, newer, safer stadia, a decrease in violence, the Premier League, and billions of pounds in TV revenue. English football was reborn on the 4th of July, 1990. Yes. 26th of July, 2009. The England and West German players of 1990 are reunited for a tribute game to Sir Bobby Robson, who was nearing the end of his 17-year battle with cancer.
He wasn't well enough to go, and the advice was for him not to go. But he was so determined to go. And we just sort of tried to make a decision that, you know, he wants to go, so let's get him there. You know, we knew it was obviously going to be his last public outing, or any outing. Sir Bobby Robson! The reception from the crowd was incredible. You know, you could see that he was so pleased to be there.
It was a poignant farewell between Robson and his great team, who together had done so much to restore pride in English football.
Had a look at me throughout a few tears. I think, well, we did lining up.
On the way back, I asked him, you know, if he enjoyed the game, and he just, you know, went yes. And then he came out with, and he asked, you know, how did Gascoigne play?
Is that what he said? He's always taking them on his money. Yes, Bobby. Is that what he said then? How did Gascoigne play?
Despite his, you know, how unwell he was still concerned about, you know, the players. I mean, it was quite incredible. It just encapsulated everything about Dad.
He was like the second dad to us, really, you know. He was a great man, you know.